Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching a brand new edition of Policy Watch with me, Frank Pereira. Recent infant deaths in hospitals across the country have thrown the spotlight on India's poor public health delivery system yet again. India's public expenditure on health is rising, but not as fast as its burgeoning population of 1.3 billion, which grows by 26 million each year. Resources are not just scarce, but their use is often not rational and optimal. Over the past two decades, successive governments at the centre and lately the National Health Policy 2017 have promised to raise India's public health expenditure to 2.5% of the GDP. Yet the current spend hovers at 1.4%. States account for 0.9% of this expenditure, with the centre's share being an abysmal 0.6% of the GDP. On this edition of Policy Watch, we will analyse what ails India's public health system. Joining me on the programme now are R.K. Srivastava, former DG Health Services, Government of India, and Alok Sharma, journalist. Thank you to both my guests for joining me on this edition of Policy Watch. R.K. Srivastava, I'd like to begin with you. What ails our public health system?
There are two major factors. The first is uncontrolled population and rapidly increasing demand. The second is a not properly organized public health system. From the time of independence, the demand was increasing continuously, and the quantum of disorganization in the public health system was also increasing. Now the result was the policy corrections which has happened in the previous policies, they were largely a knee-jerk reaction according to the situation at that time, without thinking about the capacity of the system to absorb all those provisions. It is not including only the service provision, it is also including the provision of right utilization of the money being allocated to it. So in this system for last 60-65 years, the gap between the demand and the supply has increased, and increased to the extent that many type of temporary solutions like public-private partnerships, like trying to rope in various private players in the tertiary health care to invest in the social need of the public health system for the primary care, they have been taken up. The National Health Policy 2017 is talking about it little bit more rationally. But at the end of the day, somebody has to pump in the money. If we see the increase of the money from different five-year plan, you will find that as per GDP, 0.1%.
Yes.
Per five-year plan. As we look at the population growth, with India's still TFR in major EAG states and which are contributing 50% of the population, it is above the targeted value, about 0.3 or 0.4.
Right.
So in this situation, some type of promises which has been made in the National Health Policy 2017 required a lot of in-house activities of organizing the system, which to me, I think it is about a year the policy has been declared. The things are happening with a slow pace.
Okay. Things are happening with a slow pace. It needs to pick up pace, is what you're suggesting. Alok Sharma, what are the biggest challenges as far as India's public health delivery system are concerned?
As Dr. Srivastava rightly said, that there's a huge gap in terms of demand and supply. The number of doctors or paramedics, medical staff that we need in our country is far short of the requirement. Plus, there are multiple factors to it. There's not much awareness, especially in rural areas, and these health companies, corporate health, is growing in metros and where paying capacity of people is, those who can pay, facilities are growing in those areas, leaving behind pockets of rural India, which are largely unserved. Plus, you have doctors are not willing to go to rural areas. If few doctors are willing to go to rural areas, there are no medicines. So,
it's and the infrastructure also is poor.
Infrastructure is a problem, but infrastructure surely is a problem, but this issue can be solved because the in rural areas where people need medical facilities, I think if you connect with them, discuss with them, they would offer you some area where a doctor can sit and can basically serve patients. Because I come from a background, my father is a doctor, and when he went to CHC or PHCs, there were not infrastructure available. But then if you connect with those villagers, they are willing to
accommodate
you.
Yes.
And they will basically give you a decent system to sit
to
there.
To function.
Because it is their requirement. They need a doctor there. So, but when you do not have ample supply of medicines, then a doctor really can't do much. You can and diagnosis. So diagnostics, reaching diagnostics to those rural areas is also a challenge, because again pricing becomes an issue there. It's not one problem, it's multiplicity of problems that is ailing public health system in India.
Mr. Srivastava, multiplicity of problems ailing the public health system. So do we need a multi-pronged approach? What are the suggestions that you know that we can probably work on? Is there a model that we can apply?
There's no model. You have to innovate a model. And India has got enough capacity to innovate the models. After retirement, I retired somewhere around late 2011. I have experimented with the population area for 2 years with Bihar and UP. Try to do something, difficult area. Then I switched over for primary care. For about a year, I am working in primary care. And I feel that I can give you some guideline for a right model which can be adopted on the basis of my experience. Maybe a very limited experience. I operate at present in Rajasthan, Delhi, little bit in UP, started just now. I feel that like NHS in Britain, when they started in around 1948, the basic concept of general practitioner for a captive population of about 10,000, we need to start it now through our sub-center, which has got a captive population of about 5,000. Now, let us try to see what we should do to address the basic health problem of a patient living in that 5,000 or 1,250 families. We have to create a health card. We have to use technology for converting this sub-center into a health and wellness center. And by chance, that is what has been given in the national health policy as well. There are technologies which are available. You can have a doctor, fair enough. If you don't have a doctor, use telemedicine. You should have a good supply chain management system. You should have a facility of diagnostic over there. If the diagnostic facility, like the national health policy talked about 20 such center, will have one diagnostic facility which can provide the diagnosis, and there will be persons who will take the samples and come back. There may be many other innovations. So what I am doing nowadays, I have housed two such sub-center which is operated through telemedicines in Rajasthan, in one of the sub-center, where this is Kundali Nadi sub-center, and one at the other place, and 5-6 more I am trying to put up there. There may be many more such type of solutions which may be experimented at different area. I know of some of them. There is a boat clinic in Assam. There are different type of model operating in West Bengal. Why can't we take up all these models, try to find out the good practices of them, put them as an operating test model into the large number of cities?
Sure.
And try to see what it comes out of it.
Follow good practices is what you're suggesting. Yeah, that's a very good suggestion. And there are four if it works somewhere, why can't it work anywhere else?
There are four things a patient needs. Consult, prescription, drug and diagnostic.
Sure.
Now it is not a great deal.
Sure. You know, Alok Sharma, several governments in the past, governments have said that they're going to increase spending in this particular sector, but that really hasn't happened. Why is it so? And do you believe that increasing the budget for this sector will improve it?
See, obviously, I mean, when government would pump in money, the interest among medical staff will grow. So pumping money is, however, not a solution in terms, I mean, just pumping money would not help. You have to grow other facilities around it also. You basically have to create awareness among, essentially among rural areas, because what happens is they are not keen to go to hospital or a doctor because based on their home remedies or based on their experience, they would think that do din ka rest is enough for me. Most common suggestion that people give is you sleep for 2 days and you will be all right. Mm. So one has to realize that proper, as Dr. Srivastava rightly said, that a proper diagnosis, because you delay your disease or ailment, it grows.
Right.
So
right.
Diagnosis, facilities for diagnostics have to be there, a doctor has to be there, and people also need to be aware about mindset has to change. So
Okay. Just
pumping money may not help. Yes, pumping money would definitely create infrastructure and incentivize people to go in difficult areas where people are not going as of now. But yeah, you need a multi-pronged approach, as you rightly said.
Right. All right. Fine. On that note, then, we'll call it a wrap on this segment of Policy Watch. I'd like to thank both my guests, R.K. Srivastava and Alok Sharma, for joining me on the program. Well, do stay tuned. We'll be back with another topic on the other side of this short break.
This is Kibutu in Arunachal Pradesh, East Point East on the map of India. Kibutu is dangerously close to the Chinese pressure point. We see firsthand and unseen areas of sand dunes and see how BSF is guarding this difficult territory along the Indo-Pak borderline. We are now slowly entering into the interiormost parts of the Sir Creek area. Indo-Tibetan Border Police Force justifies each word of this saying.
Watch super exclusive episodes of National Security Series only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. You're watching Policy Watch with me, Frank Pereira. Nearly 61% of deaths in India are now attributed to non-communicable diseases, including heart disorders, cancer and diabetes, according to new data released by the World Health Organization this week. Almost 23% are at risk of premature death due to such diseases. The UN agency has warned countries, including India, against premature deaths due to NCDs and said governments must step up efforts immediately. In our next segment, we will discuss what needs to be done to deal with NCD deaths in India. Joining me on the program now are Sushmi Day, Assistant Editor of the Times of India, and Rajeev Kumar, Director, Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Thank you to both my guests for joining me on Policy Watch this week. I'd like to start with the lady on the program, Sushmi Day. You know, what, as far as the WHO report is concerned, it is alarming that 61% of the deaths are caused by NCDs. What needs to be done to deal with the problem?
So, there are three segments to the problem, if we have to bifurcate it. One is, of course, awareness about these diseases, the preventive healthcare, and the tertiary healthcare part of it. If you speak to doctors and experts, they'll tell you that it's more of a lifestyle related problem, and that's the main cause for increasing incidence apart from other factors. So the awareness has to focus on bringing in more information on the table for patients, for common people, that how they should control habits in day-to-day life, how there should be more focus on exercise and, you know, healthy eating, less of stress, or how to balance stress. The preventive care also surrounds, evolves around this information. It also includes secondary or primary and secondary treatment, where there should be more focus on screening and diagnostics, and then we move on to the tertiary care where there's treatment. So these are the three segments where there needs to be more awareness and creation of infrastructure and system.
But could it only be limited to lifestyle changes? It could also be some other factors as well.
Yeah, so there is, like I said, there are factors like increasing stress. There are factors like counseling or even going for regular checkups, which are part of preventive healthcare.
Sure. Rajeev Kumar, what's the government doing? You know, clearly this is a problem. How is the government going to tackle this problem?
That's right. Very interestingly, actually. In any country, when things develop, slowly more and more mortality is attributed to non-communicable diseases and less to the communicable diseases. Like in the earlier years, we had more deaths due to communicable diseases, and now we are having more deaths due to non-communicable diseases as it is happening in any other developing, emerging economy or developed country. So the thing is that the health priorities have to change, that a gear up. For example, initially the health priorities were more towards, are still more towards, still we cannot say that, still 40% of deaths are attributed to the communicable diseases. Mm. So it's not that the priorities have to align with the fact that now we are having dual burden of diseases. So on one hand we have TB, tuberculosis and malaria, on the other hand we have non-communicable diseases. Slowly the mortality will more and more will be attributed to the non-communicable diseases. So, yes, of course, the priorities are changing, and the focus is also now more on non-communicable diseases prevention. As my co-panelist Sushmi has pointed out, that very importantly, that non-communicable diseases are many of the times are the outcome of unhealthy behaviors. So of course there could be some other factors also, including genetic factors, primarily much of it is caused due to the unhealthy behavior due to, it could be diet, it could be physical inactivity, it could be use of tobacco or alcohol. These are considered to be important risk factors for non-communicable. So yes, of course, then anything which is related to lifestyle, then the challenge is basically to somehow nudge people without being so paternalistic about it, that we have to nudge them towards healthy behavior from beginning. So keeping that in view, actually the government has started several initiatives in the past few years. For example, the flagship program, which we have a flagship National Health Mission flagship program, and National Health Mission primarily is to support the state as well as financially for interventions up to district level primarily. So when we talk about, for example, the primary care interventions, then National Health Mission is the key mission for that. Under National Health Mission, we had a national program for prevention and control for cancer, diabetes, heart diseases and stroke, which covers basically all the four more important non-communicable diseases. So in past 2-3 years, we have scaled it up. For example, from 63 districts in 2014, now we have scaled it up to more than 420 districts, 430 districts. So the one idea was basically to scale the program so that in each district there's enough capacity built at district hospital level, the CSC level, for focused intervention for non-communicable diseases, so that we have something to leverage upon. Secondly, in habit changing, we thought that, of course, all forms of media have very, very important role to play in that. At the same time, sometimes if someone from the community can nudge people towards healthy behavior, then perhaps that is also a very, very important thing. So this year we are initiating a very good new program that is for that's a population level intervention. These all programs, otherwise the programs were basically opportunistic. That is, yes. If you approach health facility, you will get services primarily. But this program which we are going to initiate is population level program. Population level means that we will go to the people. So we have about 1.4 million, 14 lakhs ASHAs, accredited social health workers. And those ASHAs were are primarily used for RCH, that is reproductive health care, child care, and mental health care. So we decided that we will leverage upon this, which is which is already available, and then we will use them to reach out to people for risk assessment.
Right.
Once we have risky population, then we know that who are the people who require more attention for habit changing. They are the people who require some nudging so that they continue with the healthy lifestyle. And they are the people who are really in the very high risky zone, so they need to go and get themselves screened.
Right.
So that if they are having any disease, so that disease can be prevented.
Sure.
So in that line, we have initiated this program. We wanted to initiate in 100 districts, but the states have enthusiastically selected more, and now we have more than 140 districts, I think, initiating this program this year. So that is very, would be very, very important intervention in terms of habit changing and that thing.
Right.
And many other interventions on tertiary care side. Like this is primarily for the primary care and for habit changing thing.
Sure. Sure, fair enough. You know, Sushmi, some very interesting points there raised by Rajeev Kumar. You know, one, of course, that the government is moving towards a dual-pronged approach, you know, not neglecting the communicable diseases as well, because they constitute 40% of the deaths. But, you know, should the prerogative be the government's to try and deal with this problem, or do you think when it comes to NCDs, it is up to the individual really to take care of themselves?
No, the government has a very important role here to play because there is a dual prong approach. As far as information and preventive healthcare is concerned, there is a certain amount of information which is already there in the domain. But there are also areas where this information is not reaching or where people are not aware about these problems. So the government has a very important role to take this information to those areas. Especially I'm talking about, you know, rural areas, villages. Like Rajeev said, you know, there we have the government has ASHAs and other healthcare workers who play a very important role to take this information door to door. Besides that, even when we talk about primary, secondary and tertiary healthcare or building healthcare systems in place where the treatment or the diagnostic comes in, the government has a very, very crucial role to play. To take services to the last mile is what the government can do, you know, where the healthcare system comes in place. They have the mechanism, they have the wherewithal. This is not a lifestyle or preventive healthcare, is just a part of the whole problem solving exercise. Beyond that, there is also a huge role which has to be fulfilled by creation of services and infrastructure, a proper healthcare system. So where the government has to step in and
treatment could be extremely expensive as well as far as NCDs are concerned.
Right.
So that's something that the government needs to take care of, because not everyone can probably afford the treatment that comes their way.
That's right. So, you know, if we see the latest initiatives, there have been a lot of focus from the government on price control of drugs, especially which fall in these categories like cancer, diabetes and hypertension. Also in terms of treatment, the government is talking about creating cancer hospitals which will provide treatment at subsidized rates.
Sure.
Or, you know, they will be public healthcare systems. So these are very important factors, and like you rightly pointed out, all these the whole NCD segment falls under a very expensive treatment procedure-based healthcare system.
You know, Rajeev Kumar, you listed out several initiatives as far as the government is concerned, and they're all great initiatives, but what are the biggest challenges that the government faces?
One thing I'll just add upon was Sushmi, I'll continue from there. Of course, since so far as these NCDs are concerned, we think that it's a whole of the government and the whole of the society approach and life course approach, which is important. Because NCDs do not develop immediately. They are the outcome of long neglect of healthcare by an individual or maybe by the community as such. So we are we have in our health policy this year also that we'll have life course approach when we talk about NCDs. So life course means interventions at every level. That is intervention for children, intervention for adults, for geriatric populations, whether these are for prevention or whether these are for treatment. And whole of the society, so that we have to, it's not only the government, but the society as such, at large, and then civil society organizations and media and academia and professional bodies. So all have to come together because this is something which is related to our own lifestyles, our own habits. Insofar as challenges are concerned, of course, challenges we can derive from this thing. Because it's something is in which we need a completely holistic and multi-sectoral approach. So multi-sectoral approach includes individuals also. It includes community also. So we see that there are implementation challenges, which would be certainly, because now there are so many stakeholders in this, whether when we talk about the physical activity, then the stakeholding is huge. The state government, then the urban development department, then the municipalities, then the community, and then RWAs, whether there are enough spaces for people to walk and all. And when we talk about, for example, this alcohol, and when we talk about, for example, how the children can be nudged towards the healthy behavior. So they involve a lot of multi-sectoral collaboration. This is one of the very important challenges which we think we have to overcome, and we are trying to do that, having to have structure,
right,
to have mechanisms to go. And so far as the treatment is concerned, of course, the treatment for NCDs is, number one, costly, and it could be because these are chronic diseases. Sometimes the diabetic needs treatment throughout the life.
Yeah.
If the cancer patient is there, most of the time the treatment has to continue for a long period of time. So these diseases, because they need treatment for a long period of time. So we are now trying to create more health facilities, as Sushmi has pointed out, as well as to reduce the cost of the treatment, somehow to reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure of the people so that it becomes more affordable.
Right. All right. On that note, then, we'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of Policy Watch. I'd like to thank my guests, Sushmi Day and Rajeev Kumar, for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have today. See you again next time.